Good evening. Welcome to the Bennington Select Board meeting. We're in session now, and we're coming, call the meeting to order. It's Monday, March 27th, 2017. We're at the Bennington Firehouse. And I'm Tom Jacobs, and I'd like to have everybody introduce themselves, maybe starting with Donald to my left.
Good evening, I'm Donald Campbell.
Hello, I'm Jeannie Jenkins.
Michael Keane, the last appearance.
I'm Jim Carroll.
Welcome, Jean Connor.
Stuart.
And I'm Stuart Hurd, in case you missed me while I was away.
Just, you know, actually, Dan did a pretty good job. We were actually going to say...
Oh, don't tell me that, please.
We're going to give you a couple extra weeks down in the Caribbean, but yeah, I know you didn't want it. What we would like to do is stand and pledge allegiance. And if, Michael, would you lead us?
Sure.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Michael. We do have a consent agenda. I'll entertain a motion for its acceptance.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second.
I'll second it.
We got a third, actually. But motion and second's fine. Has everyone had a chance to review the consent agenda? Are there any questions or discussion that you would like to have? Hearing none, I'll move for the vote. All in favor, signify by aye.
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 That's six in favor and no objections to the consent agenda being adopted. Now for the part of the agenda that which we look forward to. This is the agenda where there's no agenda. We just entertain comments by citizens. We try to limit the time just so we can get into other business. But please, if you're interested in talking with us, keeping it brief, try not to be repetitious if you can, because that will actually defeat the opportunity for other folks to come and address the meeting. So, Boyle, we do have an opportunity for you to come up, address, and please don't be redundant from previous meetings.
Well, I've been advised otherwise because you're telling me that you're not going to follow what the Constitution says. And we are in violation under the Constitution and federal law. Andrew Jackson v. John C. Calhoun says the states and cities cannot pick and choose which federal laws they will enforce. It goes on to say if any states or cities passes a law that violates federal law, it is nullified. So I don't know what's on the Vermont Constitution. I don't have to read that.
Okay, I'm glad
the U.S. Constitution.
I'm glad you're making that point. I have a feeling it's not a dialogue tonight relative to the Constitution. There are many folks in the United States that are in total agreement with you, and we're certainly not going to object to what your comments are, but we're really not going to have a dialogue relative to what the law is or isn't on the state, federal, or local level. Appreciate your comment, but we can't give you any more than that.
But you belong to the bar. And when you take the bar license, you swear an oath to uphold the Constitution. Police officers took an oath to uphold the Constitution. The people are sick and tired of our kids being put in jeopardy because you guys don't want to follow what the federal Constitution law says and the Supreme Court rulings, putting our kids and our women in danger.
Okay, I appreciate it. I don't sit here as a lawyer. I sit here as chair of the select board, and I won't speak to that. So you're free to make your comments, but that is the extent of our ability to accommodate it. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'll make the next step then. Thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you. Would you like to come up, please? And is that microphone too high or too low?
Can you hear me?
We sure can. Would you just identify yourself for the record, please?
Yes, I'm Libby Harris.
Yes, Libby.
Hello again.
Good to see you.
I'm a resident of the Apple Hill community and a member of the Apple Hill Homeowners Association. But I speak to you tonight as an intervener on both the Chelsea and Apple Hill projects. If you don't know what an intervener is, it's my house abuts both of the projects, and so any homeowners whose homes abut the projects were given the opportunity to apply for intervenor status, and I was granted that status on both projects by the Public Service Board.
Right. Thank you.
I'd like to give a little history. These projects go back to 2013, so I just wanted to give what I'm hoping is a short enough history to just bring you up to speed about how we got here. On March 1st, 2013, the SPEED program was offered by the Public Service Board, offering developers massive tax breaks to build solar arrays within a stringent period of time. Chelsea Solar asked for a certificate of the public good, which means a green light, no later than 2014. On 1-8-15 and 12-18-15, they asked for extensions and I believe have asked for further ones. On May 15th of 2015, the town of Bennington got intervenor status on the Apple Hill project. And it's through no fault of the town of Bennington that it had to wait all of that time, because when the SPEED program was offered, all of the towns in Vermont were bypassed, and the only approachable entity was the Public Service Board. And over the 2 years that this program was in effect, so many of the towns had outcry from residents about the disastrous results of the solar arrays that the towns finally, thankfully, were given intervenor status. And the reason the town was given status on Apple Hill alone was that the Chelsea project was so far along that they couldn't enter as if in the beginning. On February 16th, 2016, the Public Service Board denied Chelsea Solar its certificate of public good. They had a 63-page ruling. And Chelsea is notable because it is the only solar project in the entire state of Vermont that has ever been denied. So, all through the 63-page ruling, the town of Bennington appears. And it's basically the town of Bennington superb town plan. And I just want to refresh your memory. On page 49, I'm sure none of you read the full ruling, but on page 49 of the ruling states that on 10/13/15, a few months after the town of Bennington got intervenor status, the town of Bennington filed public comments requesting that, quote, the board halt the two solar projects, the Chelsea and neighboring Apple Hill solar projects, because of the inevitable damage to the environment, safety, visual, and aesthetic values of the natural and historic surroundings around the two project sites in Bennington. The Public Service Board substantiates that the language of the Bennington Town Plan indicates that the projects would interfere in the orderly development of the region. In addition, it cites the town plan language concerning Bennington's rural conservation districts. The town states development that will occur outside the urban growth area will be much less concentrated and shall not include new commercial uses, because such uses are incompatible with the rural character of the area. And the town plan designated four criteria. And the Public Service Board said the clearing of 10.6 acres of existing vegetation runs directly afoul of this provision in the town plan and its vision for orderly future development. So the project violates three of the four specific requirements in the town plan. Now, after Chelsea was denied, 10 days later, they filed 16 motions on Chelsea and Apple Hill until the Department of Public Service, the Agency of National Resources, and I ask for a dismissal of these frivolous notions with prejudice. And that means that their motions were so...
Cannot be raised again. They cannot be raised again if they are dismissed.
Yes.
With prejudice, yes.
Thank you, Tom.
Okay, sure.
Thank you. So, to bring us up to date, here is Chelsea and Apple Hill and the Malone father and sons back again. This time, they claim to have a new abbreviated offering for us. And they have been soliciting the town. They've been soliciting the Apple Hill Association unsuccessfully. They've been soliciting me unsuccessfully to just approve this new one. On March 20th, they offered me in writing $50,000 and $50,000 to approve these new plans. And I just want to say that no amount of money could be accepted by me to these ill-sighted, long overdue denied sites. And so I'd like Laura Block to continue the conversation about this.
Okay. Please, Laura, if you could be brief on that, because it's not really an agenda item tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Libby pretty much said a lot of what I wanted to say. I'm not here as an intervener because I'm not part of an abutting property. I'm a member of the Apple Hill Association. The one other thing I wanted to just reiterate is that our whole association, which is about 30 households, had a meeting a week and a half ago or 2 weeks ago where we were presented by Bill Knight, who's the president of our association, who apologizes for not being here tonight. He's away. And because he's been harassed basically by the Malone brothers and by Brad Smith, their representative, trying to get us to change our minds about being against the Chelsea Solar project. And so Brad said that they have a revised plan and wouldn't we be in favor of it? Do they want us to change our minds? And we voted, and the vote from the association was no. This is not a plan that we would accept. We don't really want any plan there, and we would not go along with this revision. Part of the problem is, and what they're doing, is they're trying to divide us. I think they're trying to divide the association from Libby. I'm afraid that they might try to divide the town, the select board from us, and trying to divide up by dropping little what I would call bribes and payoffs to get us to change our mind. And the other thing that I'm not happy about is that they aren't presenting a formal plan. They're just giving us pieces of paper and saying, well, what would you like this? Would you like that? Would you like this? And I don't even see how our association or any agency and the select board could even say yes or no to an informal offer like that. There's steps that they have to take. They have to make a formal plan. They have to make a formal presentation. And until they do, I certainly don't feel personally, that I would ever do their homework for them and make it easier for them by knowing that we would agree to something before they've submitted a proposal. That's their job. It's not our job to tell them what we would like before they go through all the work to do what they're supposed to do. So I'm just here to make sure that you're aware that our association did vote against this informally offered revision, which claims that it's going to be smaller. And also, the main point I'm here to ask for is your help and support, that you as a select board will stand by your intervener status and make sure that no agreement is made with the Malone brothers or Brad Smith informally or in executive session or before any kind of formal presentations are made. I'm sure that you will do everything legally, I know that, but we are just here to thank you. I would like to thank you for having a great town plan. It was so well written that the Public Service Board had to go along with what it said. And to keep that momentum, I hope we will have your support for any other revisions, in meaning that we as the association would be against them. And also your support for no backroom deals, because that's okay. we hope everything will be upfront. And I know you can't make a decision right now, but that's just what it's basically a plea right now. And we will be back for the new board. I know you're leaving, and there will be new board members, and we will be back to make the same presentation to the new board members in 2 weeks so that they hear all this again. And if I can stand here again, I was asked by Sophie Garter to read her statement. So it's not my statement.
Sorry.
Sophie Garter, do you want to come up?
Laura, I've got one
from the Public House.
I have one quick question. And in these meetings with the representatives from the Malones, have they made any written offer to you folks?
It's not really been a written offer. They've sent in plans, you know, some kind of a plan that says, well, what about this? You know, it looks smaller.
But you've at least listened.
We got it. We saw it. We discussed it at our association
meeting.
And I
think you and I talked about this.
Yes.
I talked about it with Libby. You take an arrow out of their quiver, the Malones, by at least listening, so that the PSB board can't come and say, well, you know, they didn't even...
Well, that's why we took our association vote, yes. That was what we did.
Again, I don't want to get into... That's a very good... Good points are being made. And if you'd like to make a quick comment, since you're here during citizens' comment, please feel free to do that. I can tell you this board and the successor board is not going to do anything behind closed doors without the appropriate presentations and participation. That's not the type of board that you have elected. We're a transparent and hopefully open board, and we'll hear the pros and the cons if it comes to us. But before then, we're not making any deals that you should be concerned with. If there's a deal to be made, it's going to be made in the future with the public sun on it. Is that fair to say, folks?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, Sophie from the Public Service Board she's the manager of the, I'm sorry.
Now we're getting to the agenda.
I'm afraid of public speaking and I will completely fall apart, so please allow her to speak for me. See, I'm shaking right now.
That's all right. We try to make it really comfortable, so next time.
I know.
So she has written this. This is her words, but she asked somebody to read it, so I got elected. A statement via Sophie Garter, manager of the Public House Restaurant, on behalf of the owners, Stephen and Lauren Bryant. We first want to extend deep gratitude to Rick Carroll, Mary Morrissey, and all members of the Solar Siting Committee for their continued advocacy on our behalf and for their vigilant care of the beautiful surroundings of our community, the Gateway to Vermont. Throughout the past year, we have been involved in the process of ECOS's bid to obtain a certificate of public good to build a solar field in our local community, which we strongly believe will have a negative impact on our business on Harwood Hill, as well as to neighboring businesses and residents on Rice Lane. The Public House Restaurant is considered a mainstay of this community. The history of the restaurant is well known throughout southern Vermont. There have been certainly been challenges throughout the years, but this restaurant, a charming barn on the hill with an amazing view, draws people from all over the world to appreciate everything Vermont has to offer. As a successful business, we have seen more than 20% year-to-year growth over the past 5 years. Our confidence in our community and in our business model has provided us, with thanks to the Bank of Bennington and all local contractors, the opportunity to expand, and we have in this past year opened our new event space, the Orchard Room. We are incredibly proud of our growth and investment in Bennington, especially in the current economic climate, and feel excited about our future. As this community knows, our business relies heavily on our pristine view of our great state. In fact, the view is an integral asset to our success. Should our view be impacted, and we believe it will, by any expansion from ECOS of solar fields on our neighboring property, then we believe the effects will be negative and far outside the reach of what attracts visitors to this area. The Public House appreciates and supports the need for clean and renewable energy, but strongly urges the Select Board to refrain from any support of any ECOS battlefield projects. The following is an excerpt of an email exchange between the Public House and Brad Wilson, and we hope that it further helps you understand our position. This is his words
here.
That's
our statement
to him. This is Public House's statement. Quote, "You clearly stated your intention of expanding the solar field past where the current plan exists. Therefore, we have no choice to view this current project as hostile to our business environment, and our intention is to intervene in all ways possible. The Public House restaurant is considered one of the most successful businesses in this area. We believe strongly that our community leaders realize the positive impact that our business has on the local economy. We cannot support any plan that will impact our view now or in the future. Thank you for your time and consideration."
Okay. Thank you.
Any questions?
No, we're not really going to enter into a dialogue tonight, but we appreciate your comments.
For the record, Mary Morrissey, I just wanted to further state that the reason that these good folks are here tonight is because the undertone coming from Brad Wilson and the Malone brothers is that the town fathers are somehow negotiating on something, and so there is great concern on that end of it. I'm also here to ask that, I know this is Michael Keane's last meeting, but I would hope that because he has worked hard on the subcommittee for the siting, that he may be allowed to stay on that committee to serve further.
Thank you, Mary. I think that's something that the next board will have to decide. But to also have in mind that we're not town fathers, we're selectors. Good evening.
Good evening. My name is William Stewart.
Yes, William.
And good evening, town members. I was here approximately 3 weeks ago to address the town.
Annual meeting?
At the annual meeting about the problem with Bradford Street and the water truck problems. Now, I understand you guys are the water board select, or the board for
yes,
the water board, too?
That's one of our responsibilities as selectors.
Well, you know, have you guys read the contract, the water board contract between
this predated
Mont Pure and
this predated all of us.
All right, okay. Well, at the annual meeting, we were told there was only supposed to be 7-8 trucks a day, and the trucks continual now 12 to 15 trucks a day. They still park on the street. I sent a video to the Bennington News Network today of what went on today. I had an actual truck driver tell me to F off today at the meet in front of my house while I was taking video of these trucks parking and waiting, drag stripping water, basically, is what it comes down to. The question is asked is, why isn't anything being done about this? Why does it just keep getting shoveled under the rug? We've contacted and tried so many times to get this stopped, to talk to Stuart Hurd, talk to Terry Morris. Now I'm asking you for some help on this problem, because it doesn't seem to be going away at all, not even a little bit.
Here's what I can say, because I'm not familiar with the activity, because I haven't really over...
Well, I've got video, all the video you'd like to see.
I think what I'd like to do is maybe a committee of three of us pick a time with you, and not necessarily what the water company knows about and go over there and you can give us an idea, we can get an idea ourselves?
Maybe the water company should be know about what's going on. I've been trying to deal with...
I want to see it in action without having it set up.
Oh, really? I can send you all the video you'd like to see in a day, in a week, in a month, in a year. I can send you all the video you want to see.
Stu, can you give us a little bit of a, more...
Well, yeah, so I mean, the contract allows Vermont Pure to withdraw 100,000 gallons a day. And the original expectation was that those trucks would be the larger trucks that would take anywhere from 7,000 to 8,000 gallons per trip between the hours, I believe, of either 7 or 8 a.m. and 5 p.m., 5 days a week. We've seen and understand that there are trucks now coming in that are 4,000, 5,000 gallon, so it's increased the amount of traffic on Bradford Street. We've asked the drivers of the trucks to, when if they're in line waiting, that the truck wait south to the southerly part of Bradford Street where there's a bit of a pull-off while one truck is loading, so we really only have two trucks on the street. I don't know that they're always mindful of that, but we understand that they are maintaining the hours that we've asked for and doing everything they can to mitigate or minimize the impact on the residents. The unfortunate part is Morgan Springs and the offloading facility is directly across the street from a number of residents, and I can understand that amount of truck traffic is concerning at times.
Does the contract specifically number the number of trucks per day?
No, numbers, it deals with the number of gallons.
And maybe this is the problem we should address.
We don't even set out.
They should be taking, there's more hours in a day that can be used to bring in trucks throughout the day. They start at 7 a.m. and they don't stop hitting that water rocker for every 30 minutes. There's a little slowdown between 10:30 and 11, and then they back and run the most busy time of that street is noontime, about noontime. They sit and park and wait and drag strip water the most of the rest of that day. And then they stop bringing water, stop about 4:30, they completely stop bringing water, getting water at all. And if we did the, I rewind the cameras today, 12 trucks came in there today.
Stu, does the contract specifically state the hours?
No.
Well, maybe something should be done in that area.
That was negotiated.
It's out of control.
After the fact, because we wanted to make sure that the residents were not impacted, so we tried to stay within normal business hours 5 days a week. Now, Mr. Stewart.
So there is nothing in writing?
Well, no. I think we have an agreement with them. If they violate our agreement, then we have.
All right, what are the hours, is what I'm asking?
7 a.m. to 5 p.m.
7 a.m.
But now, as I understand, the truck sizes have gone down.
Well, it varies because the contractor is contracting with various trucking companies to move the water. 100,000 gallons is a lot of water.
Yeah.
It's a lot of water. Even at 8,000 gallons per truck, that's still 9 trucks, 12 trucks a day to get to 100,000.
Has it been getting worse? Has it been getting worse?
Oh, it's gotten worse.
We've got a gentleman that's speaking. I know you want to speak.
I actually live with him in the same household.
Okay, you know what?
And I just want to make a correction to the statement. It does have times in the contract, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m., Monday through Friday, excluding state and federal holiday. I want to remind all of you, they violate that. They come at 7. The last pickup today, in fact, was just after 5 p.m., and they are here on state and federal holidays, Labor Day, Memorial Day, July 4th, when it falls during the week. So just want to make sure.
Here's what we're going to do for you folks, because it's not on the agenda. We're going to go and look at your place, look at your video, look at the contract, and see what we can do to
emulate. The police have been there. The police were there last week because one of the truck drivers decided that because I was taking video, I was harassing him. So the cops came twice in one day. When I wasn't even out front, I wasn't even on the video. The police looked at the video, nothing went on. So we got tractor trailer drivers because they make so much noise. There is no silence, they run clutch fans, they leave them idling all the time. This one truck company, Lucier and Jay Stone, they're these huge Peterbilt tractor trailers made to pull the big water tanks like Stuart Hurd said, 8,000 gallon trucks. Now these trucks are bringing little tiny tanks and the trucks are obnoxious. They are the biggest tractor trailers on the roads, and they sit and park across the street from that house, down the street from that house, and idle all the time. Lucier Trucking is the biggest violator of the idling law and anywhere. He never shuts a truck off. The guys get aggravated because I take video of them. I had one of them today and got that on video when it's on the Bennington News Network. The guy told me to F off because I was taking video of him screaming that truck. He pulled out of there so fast on the video, he should have got a speeding ticket on the street. And then when he got to the end of the street, the buildings, the grounds and building trucks came around the end of the road off of, what's the name of that street? Coolidge Street. And almost ran right into that tractor trailer, came down the street. That's on the video if you want to see. And then, because he seen me in the street videotaping him, he started backing up on Main Street and then realized the ground and building trucks were right behind him. Check the video out. It's on the news network, on YouTube. Send it out this afternoon. Now, there's one more question.
Yeah.
Last summer, they decided to put an electric fence to make these trucks come in faster. Every truck has a garage door opener. They can open and close the garage from down the street. This is what made this keep going even faster. The town put in this electric gate. Now, who authorized the gate? How much did it cost? And who paid for it? Did we pay for it? Did the slush fund pay for it, that 65 grand, the little bit of money we make off this water? I think this contract should be renegotiated, and we need to make more water, more money off this water if this is how this is going to be on this street, because it's unlivable. In the summertime, when the windows come open, you can't have a window open because there's so much tractor-trailer traffic. It's unlivable. The quality of life is zero.
Did you live there before this whole
contract? Oh, yeah. I've been there for 11 years.
It was a pretty quiet neighborhood before?
It was real quiet. Yeah. Five trucks a day, six trucks a day. And then it started slowly getting to be 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 15. I had 16 trucks in there a little over a month ago on a Monday. Mondays and Fridays, they bang it so hard, you can't believe it. My house vibrates every half an hour. There's so much traffic going in and out of that hot water aquifer. It just doesn't seem that it's right to me that all this money should be being made on this water, and it's not. I mean, these trucks are just complete. I've talked to Lillian Sleeman. She's had enough of the water trucks. She lives right next door to me. She's up late. She's an elderly woman, and she's woke up every day at 7 a.m. by them trucks. So something has to be done. I mean, it's gotten out of control. Maybe you need to have a schedule for these trucks. They come one every hour, 5 days a week, and I'm sure they can get all the water they want. Believe me. It's that one every half an hour that makes the street unbearable.
I'll be in touch with you personally.
I'll give you my phone number. Okay. I'll let you know anything you want.
Okay. Thanks. Is that all right with the board if I proceed that way?
Yeah.
It's...
I thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Just one comment, if I may. I mean, we've just heard from Libby Harris, from Laura Block, about trying to keep an aesthetic, preserve an aesthetic in our area. And on the other side, we have somebody complaining about another type of aesthetic ruin that's happening. So I'd like to see us... You guys do what you want after time, but I'd like to see us find some way to help this situation the way we're trying to help in terms of the solar array site.
Okay. Other comments? Oh, Michael, go ahead.
Are you going to take comments on what BCIC is going to talk about on the agenda tonight?
Yeah, we haven't got to the agenda.
You're going to take citizen comment?
Yep.
Okay,
thanks. We sure are, Michael.
It's a second reading.
Well, save it for next time, okay? We're really already into the business.
I just want to verify.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, I appreciate that, and I don't doubt it at all. Let's go on to the, sorry.
Just concerned that it's a second reading. To Mike's point, are we in fact going to take comment?
Oh, I always like, you know, I know the second reading, we don't welcome.
But you will.
But yeah,
okay.
I think it's only second reading. We normally don't have to because that's already the opportunity. But
just wanted to make sure.
Yep.
Good.
And I actually have to ask the board if you would welcome it. Mm-hmm. If not welcome it, accept it.
Just left.
Hmm?
Just left. Well...
I don't know if he left or he had use the facility.
Is that talking with the last?
Okay, let's go to the next.
Give the doors in order here.
Mary, could you obviously either step out or step away, or because we're trying to conduct business? Okay, please, thank you. The next item on the agenda deals with the second reading of the Bennington County Industrial Corporation contract, which has been circulated, and we've all had the opportunity to hear Bill Colvin, and we've had an opportunity to look at the document itself. I can tell you, based upon my reading of the document, that it seems like this is a win-win proposition for the community. This is a perfect, the timing couldn't be better. We're being offered an opportunity to have assistance in our economic development component. We're right now, Stewart's is dealing with redoing a description for what will be the Bennington, our community development director, which would take that component out of that what has been previously our town responsibility. It's a one-year contract. It cost us $25,000. Stuart, could you just indicate where those funds will be coming from?
Sure. Because we'll be essentially changing the duties and responsibilities of the now community development director, we'll be reducing some of the demands on that position. Approximately $15,000 is anticipated to come from the salary line item for that position. And then we have recommended that an additional $10,000 to make the $25,000 would come out of the reserve funds that we've been setting aside for the Southern Vermont Economic Development opportunity or effort, at least for this year, because there are money set aside to bring us together with two county, Windham and Bennington County. Effort on economic development, and I think that that's one of the responsibilities that we are asking of this position, now funded through BCIC, so that it makes sense to use some of those funds, at least in this year, to get the contract underway. In subsequent years, we'll be budgeting for those funds under another purchase services line item, and they'll be shown probably as a separate account, much as we do with some of the other special contracts we have. Either with BCRC or others.
If there's a decision to renew the agreement
in some
form or context.
Yes, we would most likely anticipate that, but that's up to you folks.
While you may be taking some money from the Southern Vermont Economic Development Zone, it is stipulated in this proposal that there will be development of a Southern Vermont Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy. So we're really essentially paying for the same thing. So that, I think it works out to be a nice balance.
Yes, I agree.
I think the only real observation and concern that I have, and maybe some of the other board members have, and Jim Sullivan, who's here from BCRC, can probably speak to, is the resources of person power. Bill's taking on a lot of responsibility, and the BCRC's ability to support the effort going forward, because it does call for a lot of, there's a significant amount of accountability which BCIC is willing to take on itself. Jim, maybe you could just comment on that. Jim Sullivan?
Sure, thank you, Tom. My name is Jim Sullivan. I'm the Executive Director of the Bennington County Regional Commission, and Bill Colvin, who you mentioned, has been talking with you folks about this issue, is out of town this week, so I'm covering. And Jonathan Cooper is here. He's our Community and Economic Development Specialist, who is really primarily responsible at this point for implementing a lot of the BCIC work tasks, so you might want to talk with him, too. As far as the staffing support goes, we're at a position for background for folks who don't know, the Bennington County Regional Commission works with the Bennington County Industrial Corporation. They pay us a portion of the funds that they get from the state to execute their state contract with the Agency of Commerce and Community Development, which provides a range of general economic development services that is consistent with all the regional development corporations like BCIC around the state. So what, you know, we're talking about here is really focused, targeted, supplemental assistance directed for the town of Bennington. And the question is, as I understand it, does the commission have the capacity to take on that additional work given what we're already doing? And you know, I would say that we certainly do. We've made an effort to increase our staffing in the economic development side of the organization since we started working with the BCIC. You know, we hired Bill Colvin several years ago to start up the community and economic development effort. Just in the last year, we hired Jonathan, as Bill became, as you mentioned, very involved in the Putnam Block redevelopment project and overseeing the full range of things we do in economic development. We also hired Michelle Morocco, who had been working on a lot of initiatives with the town as a VISTA organization to be a community development assistant. So we now have three full-time people working in that area. We certainly do have a lot of responsibilities between executing the state contract, working on the Putnam Block, the Southern Vermont Economic Development Zone, and the SEDS. You know, things like Career Week, the internship program, cultural Bennington initiatives, ongoing community development support work, especially with the town. So there's a lot going on, to be sure, but at the same time, we've really made an effort to step up and make sure that we have adequate staffing. And I think that we've, you know, we've gone from probably being one of the most understaffed regional development efforts in the state to at least being on par with most of the other regional development corporations. And I think that we've, the one thing that we have done is recognize that we really need to, you know, make sure that we have the ability to focus and target our economic development efforts to be responsive to municipal concerns and issues, like we do with the Bennington County Regional Commission, where you know all of the member towns in the region provide direct financial support to the commission. Really, what this proposal does with the BCIC and the town is something similar, where it really lets us look at our state contract, look at our obligations, and say, okay, recognizing that, you know, Bennington is really the biggest economic driver for a municipality in the region, where are the needs, where are the concerns, how can we most effectively deploy the staff resources that we have? So, you know, at this point, given the language of the proposed agreement, I don't have any particular concerns. Given the increasing staffing that we've made, I mean, what you know, we're gonna always be dynamic. We're always gonna be, you know, shifting a little bit to try to meet where the demands are. Right now, this is where the demands are. This is really a model that I'd like to pursue to make sure that the BCIC programs, as executed through the Regional Commission, are as responsive as possible to municipal needs.
Well, in that context, do you anticipate that you'll be working with other existing entities, Chamber of Commerce, the Downtown Bennington Association, or the BCA, and probably others? Because I expect there's a lot of work that is being done and an attempt not to be redundant with whatever also is being done.
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, that's a good point. And I think one of the real efforts here is to try to increase coordination and complementary work activities without being redundant. You know, we like to say there is a regional economic development organization, and it is anything in planning or economic development, it's absolutely essential if you want to be effective to coordinate and work with other organizations who are involved. So we want to complement the activities of the Bennington Chamber, of the you know, the regional economic development work that's going on through the Shires organization, absolutely with the Downtown Association, and you know, also recognizing the you know, the interregional interest and benefits, as we've talked about with the Southern Vermont Economic Development Zone. You know, we'll continue to work with our partners in Windham County and in other adjacent regions. So there's constant coordination going on, but there's no question as far as the specifics of this agreement with the town of Bennington. We will be in regular contact with the other players that are operating in the community.
Would you object to that being a provision within the contract itself?
No, absolutely not. Like I said, that should be a part of what we're doing. It should go without saying, but absolutely put it in the agreement.
Okay. I'll defer to my colleagues, maybe Donald.
Yeah, I think we could make a motion. I don't know if we need to make a motion, but it feels to me like we could make more explicit in this that BCIC will work closely with the BDA on downtown issues, including development, recruitment, and physical enhancements.
And other entities like Chamber.
And the Chamber, and so I think we could probably stand to enumerate those in the contract.
I think
you probably wouldn't mind, because that's where you're heading anyway, right?
We certainly don't mind. I mean, you know, Bill did caution me. He said, you know, we're going to work with those organizations, but again, we want to complement the work that they're going to do and not be redundant. And a little bit concerned that if we identify specifically recruitment as an activity of the BCIC, that it might be both redundant and put detract from the other work we're going to do if so much time is spent in that area.
Yeah, I don't think I anticipated be specific relative to recruitment, but the general mission of this agreement would be we'd be assured that you would work closely, whatever that means, with the other entities, and maybe specific, including, but not limited to, the Chamber and the downtown Bennington.
Well, absolutely not. And I don't want to be dismissive of the notion of recruitment either. I mean, clearly, as part of the, you know, the redevelopment work that we're engaged in, you know, we're continually talking with folks, the businesses and other institutions to bring into the downtown. So that's part of the ongoing work with that. We're just a little cautious about, you know, replicating that rule.
Okay. Especially in the downtown area. Bill was good about that when he was talking about it. But there is a piece in here about recruitment, right, to other pieces of land and other physical properties that might be worthwhile. So there's some site promotion and site location assistance.
That's absolutely. So. I mean, that's, you know, again, that's part of what the BCIC, the Regional Development Corporation, needs to be doing. We'll, you know, identifying those sites, documenting those sites, providing reports about those sites, making that information available to businesses who are interested, making that information available through to the downtown group and other folks who are involved, making it available to the town. That's clearly part of the role.
Yep.
Jeannie, can I ask a question? So, I mean, in the past, my understanding is Mike Harrington had regular meetings with the Bennington Downtown Association, the Chamber, and with BCRC, so that information was shared, and if one person was going, you know, if one person had been contacted, then you're making sure that the proper information is getting to anyone that's interested in moving into the area. So, I mean, I think there is value in having language that promotes that kind of continued sharing of information, because I think otherwise we do end up with one entity hearing about something but not knowing that that entity is also working with another organization if they're not regularly sharing information. So it feels to me like it would be useful to have specific language that says that will be happening. Is that a concern?
I would think that'd be our way of measuring the success or not of the activity, and I hope that's what Jim would echo.
Yeah, that's yeah, that's fine. I think that, you know, we just want to make sure that it's understood, you know, what the role of the BCIC is, you know, in conjunction with the other organizations. That's all.
I think we have that, right? But one of the great benefits of this is it's going to bring some clarity to all that, and it's going to bring some coordination to all that, and presumably eliminate a lot of overlap and inefficiency and things slipping through the cracks and whatnot.
I feel like
that's what we're, that's the biggest thing I feel like we're getting out of this.
From my perspective, you know, I was looking at, you know, dealing with the Bennington County region is, you know, we're a small we're a small region. You know, 35,000 people is, you know, not exactly the size of a moderate-sized city in most states. We really have to all pull together to make this work, and I think there's real value in having a strong known entity as being kind of like the focus of economic development activities. So, With the BCIC properly positioned as a regional development corporation, and working on an ongoing basis in a coordinated fashion with the various interest groups and organizations in the town, I think we would have that. Because I think previously, if somebody came, they might not know exactly where to go, or they might not be fully satisfied with the response they got. So hopefully now, you know, we have the resources available to really provide the information that people need and to make the connections that people need when they're looking at the community.
I think this is a very good opportunity, if not a great one, and I think part of what we're trying to do is nail down things that will be nailed down eventually. It's my old sense is on this, let's do it based upon this agreement and we fix it as we go along. One question I have, and it goes back to Michael Keane's Mack truck theory. Let's say Bill Colvin, who is in charge of all these things, walks across South Street from BCRC to the bank and gets hit by a Mack truck. He's not killed, he's not dead, but he's out of commission for a few months. What happens? What's the backup plan there?
Does Jonathan Cooper get killed too?
What do you say, Jonathan?
Were they at lunch together?
I just want to keep you safe from traffic.
Hey, Jonathan, feel free to come up and get
introduced. Come on up and introduce yourself,
yeah,
too.
Please.
That's my only concern.
You know, as one of the things we do at the Regional Planning Commission, we work on what's called traffic calming to slow vehicle speeds down in our downtown, so we don't have to worry about these types of incidents. But seriously,
Oh, I was serious.
I mean, as far as making sure that we've got the capacity to fill in if something unexpected happens, and, you know, I do think that certainly having several people involved on an ongoing basis, provides you with a lot of continuity. I think, you know, I'm involved to an extent, obviously, Jonathan is and Michelle is, so there's a lot of knowledge in the organization, and as I said, we'll be working with whoever, you know, the folks in the town, the new community development director, we'll be working with John Shanahan, we'll be working with Matt Harrington. So, I mean, they'll and everyone in the office will be communicating.
I wasn't being facetious, I was being serious, but I also have very great respect for all of you. I think you do great work. I just wanted to check that one point.
Thank you.
I just wanted to add that, in my examination of this, and the presentations that you and Bill have done, the one thing that frustrated me often was the seeming overlap but not coordination with promotion and recruitment. And to my mind, what this satisfies with me is that we've got more than one blade in the fire. We've got approximately four different organizations that are all committed to the same thing. So the more is the better for us and for the town.
Back to Michael's comment, which is good, as always. We sure are going to miss your good comments. One thing I do like about this is that you've given us the ability to try it on for a year. So for a relatively low price, we can try this for a year, and we can evaluate it, and we're going to have monthly meetings with your gang and be able to see what progress is being made. And we have the opportunity at the end of that year to decide it's working or not working for us. So I'm really thankful that you brought us the ability to kind of get in slowly and make sure that it is working for our community.
Well, absolutely, and I would be willing to bet that at the end of the year you'd want to make some adjustments. You know, because this is the first time that we're doing something. We learned from it. I mean, we kind of threw out the solid waste management thing initially and with the town and started working with the town. Eventually that led to, you know, I think a pretty effective solid waste alliance for the region that's benefited the town. So I absolutely agree with you. A one-year agreement makes a lot of sense. You know, first time you do it, let's try to get it right. Let's learn from the first year. Let's make adjustments.
Tom, do you want some kind of a motion on?
I just want to ask.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
I think this is great, and I think we've got an amazing team of people to do this. But I also think that because this contract could be used again and again and again, hopefully, I think clarity and making sure that we have crossed as many T's and dotted as many I's as we can on the outset is probably beneficial, so I think that's really good. I just want to make sure that the scope of work is extensive. Are we really going to see all of this work done in the first year? This is a lot. I just wanted to clarify that, or if this is your hopes and dreams, but we shouldn't really.
And it's a good question. In developing work programs, there's always a tendency to throw everything in it, and you say, do 97 different things, really, what are the priorities? I think that what we're looking at here is, a number of things that are pulled from the state contract that we're going to be doing with our full staff anyway, but focused on Bennington and really targeted and done in communication and coordination with the groups and the individuals working for Bennington. So, it's not like a complete add-on. Part of it's like really kind of focusing and targeting work that we're doing anyway.
Okay. And I had one other clarification. On the last page of the scope of work, reporting and communication, it says meeting regularly. Is that monthly? I guess I'm just, should there be some clarity on...
Bill had talked about a monthly check-in.
Then maybe we might want to add in
monthly,
not just regularly, because that could mean many things.
She's reading a monthly written report here.
Okay.
But the first is just regular meetings. And I think verbally, Bill said something like quarterly.
I would think for us, for to be having it as a part of an agenda, I would want to have it quarterly.
Okay.
But
you may want the scope of work then to just align with that.
Yeah. The other thing...
You can add that in, right, Tom?
Yeah, I think that would be a good idea. If we were talking just about the BCIC 2 years ago or 3 years ago, this probably would not be a venture that the town would want to get into. But we've already seen the early efforts of the BCIC members to orchestrate and develop the mission with BCRC's assistance. So it's not the old BCIC, other than the BCIC Industrial Corporation. Maybe a name change is in order. Maybe that's being talked about. So I think this is a new effort. And as Jim said, it's a consolidation of efforts to take away some of the redundancy, but to make sure that we get reporting of value and the result. When you have so many folks doing so many things, there's no way to hold accountability of those individuals or organizations. This gives us the contracted vendor to actually speak up and be able to hold that hold them to the fire. So that's what I'm hoping for.
Tom, I just want to say thank you for that. And we are very proud of the work that we've done to bring together a collaboration between the Regional Commission and the Regional Development Corporation. I think it's something that probably should have been in place, frankly, everywhere in Vermont for a long time to more closely wed planning and economic development. I'm impressed with the BCIC board and the BCRC board for recognizing the opportunity and starting to work together. And I think that initiatives like this with the town of Bennington is an outgrowth of that, the forward looking by those boards.
Great, Jim. Does everyone know Jonathan Cooper? Okay. Do you know Jonathan? Jonathan, could you just come up and just identify yourself? Since you're going to be part of this, just to meet you, so that when next time you come probably before us on some kind of a quarterly report, you'll be ready to face off against Jim Carroll. But do you feel it's pretty consistent with what you would hope and be able to deliver to the town based upon Jim's comments and our understanding of the agreement?
Yes, I do. Okay. Yes, I am Jonathan Cooper. I've been here in Bennington since September, both as a resident and as an employee at BCRC. I came up from New Haven, Connecticut, and in my time here, I've been able to get involved with a number of rewarding and sort of long-term projects. And so, as you know, Bill and I were going over some of the contents in this contract, and Jim and I had continued conversations about it, it all made a lot of sense to me in the time that I've been working on that BCIC-ACCD contract. It gives a good opportunity for the town to have a lot of input on how those sort of elements of the contract can be directed best towards Bennington's benefit. And I think that's sort of provides a good bit of dialogue in sort of bringing that contract to bear for the sort of capital of this region's economy. So I think it makes a good bit of sense from my perspective as well.
Great. Well, thanks, Jonathan. Nice to meet you on behalf of the board and otherwise.
Thank you.
We don't normally take citizens' questions, comments, or concerns, but I need the board if you would allow that to occur tonight, because normally it's the first meeting, we have the reading opportunity for comment, then we come back and come up with ours. But Michael, do you have something you'd like to add to the discussion?
Yeah, I mean, there's been a lot of words said, and I have total faith in Jim Sullivan, but I think in your quarterly, a couple of things, in your quarterly thing, you ought to have Jim Sullivan come back and make the presentation to you. He sold it to you. Make him come back and tell you how it's working, how it's not working, where it needs to be adjusted. The $25,000,
Mike, do you mean Jim Sullivan?
You mean Bill Colvin.
Or Bill Colvin.
No, Jim Sullivan.
Okay. Just wanted to make
the
sure.
The head of the whole thing.
Yep. Okay.
Bill Colvin, no offense. His face is on everything, and I think that's going
to
hurt.
Just wanted to find out.
Jim Sullivan.
Just clarifying.
I do have concerns for other merchants and property owners downtown that if all the concentration is going to put on the Greenbergs thing, are they going to feel slighted like the hotel motel people did when you gave $15,000 for a survey? You got still downtown, if this is basically what it's talking about, you've still got the Tuttle's property, you've got Aubuchon's, and I'm sure there's other ones. Those things need to be brought into this because BCIC and BCRC is a regional issue. They already get big money from the state, both of those organizations. I hope also this $25,000, by putting it into Jim's hands to do something positive with it, we take some of that salary away from our community development director's position.
I think you might have been out of the room.
I think you might have been out when he said
it. Okay. And the other thing, too, I think, you know, I'm a strong advocate for cold calling and recruiting. And one thing that showed me that it works is that lady from UCS with the YMCA. One call, and the YMCA is going to do something.
Yeah. Can I respond to that?
Yeah, I think just probably quickly. A clarification would probably be helpful.
So it was not a cold call. What the cold call part of it was that Betsy did not know Randy. A group of individuals reading the recreation study saw that we were in the Berkshire Y catchment area, and we elected Betsy to make the call. So it was a cold call, only that she didn't know the director of the Y. It was not that she was calling Ys in Arizona and Massachusetts. So it was not a cold call in any sort of classic sense.
It still was a reach out. We identified what we wanted.
Yes.
Somebody should have been in our staff to have done this years ago, because Justin Corcoran, sitting on this board, recommended it at least 3 to 4 years ago. And we should do that from our staff. And this is what kind of got me about our community development position. We don't do that. Like Jimmy just said, we don't sort of connect the dots and everybody's running in all directions. Jimmy Carroll. Jim Sullivan, I think, will keep an overlook of this. And I hope it works that way. And a year is a good trial period for it. But BCIC and BCRC does get a lot of money from the state. And I think you people ought to educate yourself on how much money they get before you start just, you know. And BCIC also, their board needs to change. Not just industrial now, do like Brattleboro, they do commercial and industrial.
Yeah.
So those are the things I just urge you. But I give a vote of confidence in Mr. Sullivan. He owes me money and he's got to pay it now. He lost the bet.
Thanks, Mike. Oh, yes, please.
Good evening. My name is John Shanahan. I'm the director of the Bennington Downtown Alliance. It's so much easier than Bennington Corporation. At any rate, I'm up here to talk a few things. And I think the conversation that the select board is having with Jim about adding something to the contract is very important, but I understand Jim's bit of hesitation about putting into the contract. And I think it comes down to accountability for the BCIC being responsible for bringing the Bennington Downtown Alliance and the Bennington Chamber of Commerce together to meet and discuss what I've been doing, what Matthew's been doing, and what Bill and Jonathan will be doing. And that's something that Michael Harrington of the town's Economic and Community Development Department's been doing now for years. Who is going to be responsible for that now? Does Jim want to be responsible for bringing us together? Or is that still going to be a responsibility of the town of Bennington, the Community Development Department? Where does that fall? And I understand his hesitation is I wouldn't want to be responsible for the chamber telling me all of the recruitment efforts and phone calls and stages that they're all at. And I don't think either one of them would want to be responsible for ours either. Michael Harrington, Matthew Harrington, and myself have been getting together because Michael used to report to you, here's what we've been working on. Here are the stages and the steps we're at. Where that falls, I would like to see it still be coming out of the town of Bennington. If Jonathan and Bill get hit by a bus, does the town of Bennington still oversee all of the economic development activity in town with one organization or another?
Basically, the town of Bennington does not have the manpower, the bench strength to do this. And so this is where we see there's a commonality of effort and resources. So I don't think what has been done in the past should be thrown out, but I think it's going to be augmented with more coordination. And we can look to the BCRC as to whether or not there's been a value added to that effort.
Yeah, and if it does get added to the contract, I understand that. Yep. And you'll be paying for that, and it's part of the contract. And Matthew and I will make it happen with them anyway. We meet with Jonathan. We meet with Bill all the time. It's just the reporting to the select board. If that's something you want to continue, then contractual or not, Matthew and I will step up and meet with them because we do anyway. But the reporting is crucial because it keeps us all on track of what step and stage is everybody at.
Okay. That's helpful.
Important.
If I may, Tom, certainly the community development director's position will continue to act as a liaison between and among all of those organizations, just as Michael has.
Yeah.
What we're passing on is the economic development specific portion of that effort. But certainly whoever we hire will be charged with meeting with you and Matt and certainly BCRC and BCIC to keep that communication going. I mean, when this calls for a regular meeting with town representatives, that community development director is going to be one of those representatives at the meeting.
Sure.
And I suspect that would go on just as it has in the past. Now, yeah. Matt and the new person may not be as close as they currently are, but with Michael's leaving us, we'll find somebody who can work with you folks very closely.
Make a comment, please. No concern.
Stu, if you look at the draft document concerning the community development director's position, I think that item number 3 pretty much covers that sort of coordination and coordinating activities with development partners in the development of short and long-term economic and or community development plans, gather, interpret, and prepare data for studies, coordinate activities with other departments and outside agencies as needed. I think it pretty well is covered there.
Very good.
Assuming that this particular description is authorized by the board.
But then aren't we crossing over community and economic development lines again? I thought we were separating these out.
You can't segregate community development from the economic development activities. If you do that, now you've created this parallel universe that is simply not going to work. I think the community development director is a staff person, regardless of his or her title, who has a liaison effort It can't necessarily be the manager, it can't necessarily be the assistant manager or the planner, but that staff person with that kind of language has that opportunity to meet and communicate effectively and bring back that information. Doesn't mean they're going to run out and do economic development, but someone has to be there from a staff perspective to carry that message both ways.
Okay.
I'd like to say one thing that John has brought to my attention, and that is with the reformation of the BCIC. And now we have the coordination of all these, you know, the chamber, the Bennington area.
Downtown.
Downtown Association.
Alliance.
Downtown Alliance.
But here's the point that I want to make is that, you know, under this reformation, particularly with respect to the regional economic development, as well as site promotion and site location assistance, I'd just like to just throw this idea out that you're going to have competing entities that now will be coordinating with one another, and just suggest that you come up with common goals that would fit under the umbrella or the rubric of the BCIC and work towards that. Work towards common goals. That's just my suggestion.
It's always been that way. We've never been competing organizations. We've always worked together. And I should have started this off by saying the Bennington Downtown Alliance, and Matthew, if I might speak for the Chamber of Commerce, full support of the move that's being made with the BCRC, BCIC taking on this role. The best thing to happen in BCIC is the transformation it's been going through recently, bringing them into such a tight fold that we've already all been part of. None of us have ever competed. If IBM is interested in Bennington, or if we're interested in IBM, has nothing to do with me. They're not going to be coming downtown, and I don't do anything with manufacturing. And if somebody wants to open up a kitchen shop, right, BCIC has never been interested in that. They turn it over to me. That's the way, assuming it's still going to work. My relationship is with the property owners downtown, and it's a specific boundary. 10 feet out of that, I turn it over to Matthew. I turn it over to BCIC or BCRC. It's not what we're charged with. That wasn't ever my concern. My concern was years ago, the term was, we were all siloed. That's been taken care of. We all know our roles and we work together and communicate. My concern was, I don't want that lost. I trust the BCIC and the BCRC will continue that. And if it's in the contract, we'll continue to work with it. And if he's doing the quarterly reporting to the select board, that's the way it should be. And I'm not sure if that's exactly what was being addressed.
No, my question is,
they would be
responsible. Heretofore, have you guys worked together to identify common goals?
Mm-hmm. Of course.
And work towards them?
Of course.
Okay.
It never has been a time when we didn't. And I'll go back 10 years. I can't even imagine 40 years ago that we would ever work against each other. But we do. The word redundancy gets used a lot, and I understand it because I do recruiting, and the Chamber does recruiting, and BCRC does recruiting. We do different types of recruiting and recruiting tools, and we have different levels of ability. Just because we all do it doesn't mean we're all doing it with one company. There's a million different places in Bennington, a million different opportunities, and when we do individual recruiting or preparing recruiting tools, as long as we're all working together, which we have been, it's not a one-person job, it's not a three-person job. So I don't like that word redundancy, because I'm not doing his job and he's not doing mine. We're doing our jobs together, which is the way it should be. And I think the way it's being set up now is going to be very effective.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. I would just read out of this Regional Economic Development Capacity and Coalition Building. It says right here, more or less what you're trying, I think what you're getting at. BCIC will facilitate opportunities to build connections, share resources, and leverage assets among and between area and regional organizations. businesses and municipalities to improve the economic vitality throughout the region.
Yeah.
And it feels to me like that's what you have been doing, that's what this is going to enhance, and there may be a little bit of a leap of faith in that this is not a very specific statement, but I think we know what you're getting at. I think we know what Jim Sullivan and Bill Colvin are getting at, and I think we need to push this forward and
let's get on with it.
I'd like to make a motion we accept this.
I'll second that.
Okay, and further discussion on the context of it.
Can I ask that we add to the motion authorizing the manager to sign the contract when it's finalized?
And so authorizing the manager to sign the contract as discussed and presented tonight with those provisions?
With the few revisions that we've discussed already.
Yeah, I understand there's going to be some language changes slightly.
A few minor revisions, something about quarterly or more frequently, and something about maybe itemizing some of the partners.
Yep. Is that okay with the rest of us?
Yeah, I need to abstain. Yeah.
Good. If there's no further discussion, I'll move the vote. All in favor of the contract with the Bennington County Industrial Corporation, signify by aye, giving the manager authority to execute the final document in our stead. Signify by aye.
Aye.
Aye. That looks to be 5 in favor and no objections and 1 abstention.
There you go.
Great. Thank you. We have other business to come before us in the form of a manager's report.
Yes, I just have one action item tonight. It has been determined by bond counsel that in order for us to do some interim borrowing on the public works facility, we need a motion from the board to confirm and ratify a finding of necessity. And these are specific terms given to us by bond counsel that allow the People's United Bank to loan us interim funds. So we're asking the board to make that finding of necessity with respect to Department of Public Works garage improvements approved, and you've got the rest of the motion, Article 2 at the March 7th, 2017 annual meeting. So I seek that motion.
So moved.
We have a second. Any further discussion on the interim financing process relative to the bonding of that project?
What's the next time we would hear back from you on this?
I know the documents have already begun to be developed. I suspect that it will be no later than the last meeting in April. We'll be back with the resolution and all of those certificates that we generally run through when we do bonding. Probably be joined by the town clerk and the treasurer at that particular meeting. That will deal with the interim financing. And then ultimately, we'll be getting similar documents from the bond bank probably sometime in late May. I think the closing is now currently scheduled for the end of May on the building itself. So our initial borrowing will not be the full amount. It'll be something around 2.2 to 2.5 million. That allows us to buy the building and begin our activities. And then we'll be back with the entire amount through the Vermont Bond Bank.
Okay.
Late May, early June.
Okay. Yeah, with the reconstituting of the board, it seems like we could pause, but since we've had a public vote, it seems no reason to, and I'd say we move forward with this right now.
That's my feeling, too, because it's actually already been approved by the voters.
Right.
It's really getting from A to C. All in favor of the motion, signify by aye.
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 Everyone says.
And that's all I have.
6 in favor and no abstentions. Other business to come before the meeting? Jane?
I just had a question on the FYI, the job description. Are you looking for comments on that, or was it just literally
Anytime.
An FYI?
No, really,
okay.
Please.
I'll send them
if
to you.
If you have comments, we'd love to have them. And I mean, it's been out there circulating. Obviously, the sooner we get this out and begin advertising for the position, the sooner we'll fill it.
Okay, but I'll email you.
Maybe you can give us an idea of what's your timeline for that process.
I'd like to start tomorrow.
Because of the BCIC?
Yeah, we were waiting for the BCIC contract to be finalized. I suspect that we can now put our heads together, and if you've got comments you want to make on this, we've had some input from various board members, but we would love to get this out, and we're going to get it out regionally, probably most through via the internet, various job sites. So we'll get a wide splash on this. We're not going to be just looking local on this particular position.
I'd like to thank both Michael Keane and Justin Corbin for their service to our community.
You're welcome.
I learned a lot from both of you. The trait I admire most in anybody, and I think for those of you that know me, is fearlessness. And you both stuck your necks out. Justin, who he and I are at opposite ends of the political spectrum, I nevertheless respect him for his tenacity and his smarts. He turned me around on Johnson controls, and I didn't think that would ever happen. But he made a sensible argument that I believe will benefit both the property owner and the town. Now, with respect to you, Mr. Keene.
Yeah.
From the first time that I met you at my car.
Yeah.
I was just so impressed with how you had jumped in.
Listen to this.
He had jumped in with both feet.
You've come to bury you, not to praise you.
That's right.
Yeah, I know.
I know. You came to town and you weren't tentative. You didn't stick a toe in the water. You jumped in with both feet and were on every board imaginable.
Well, that's the way I live my life.
I know it.
And that's why I've gotten this old. This quickly.
And the fact that you're a fellow Irishman, and I think you and I have said this to each other before, you know, we're both Irish, and we like a good fight. I just want to say thank you, and thank you to your wife as well, Edie, for...
You need to thank Edie for her patience with me. No question about it. Thank you, Jim. I appreciate it.
Gene, go right.
Well, I also want to say...
Well, I have something to say.
Hey, no, you can't. I'm the chair.
Yeah, you get skipped. No, I also want to say thank you. I've learned a lot from you, working with you on the what is now Bennington Downtown Alliance Board.
Yes, yes.
And on this board and on various economic development initiatives. You're a very smart man. You're very generous.
Isn't this sweet?
Yeah, it is. You're very generous with your time and with your knowledge, and I'll sorely miss that knowledge on this board.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, and there are a lot of things we're going to miss about both you and Justin. You both brought unique and wonderful things to this board. And I'm sorry Justin's not here that we could give him a little ribbing in person. But he certainly did serve a good long time on the board, and he was really a steady hand on the tiller in a lot of times. And he and I didn't always agree, but we always had a good time working it out and trying to do what we thought was best for the community. As for you, Keene,
go ahead.
We are sorely going to miss your pithy phrases and fantastic insights and quotes and comments. But we're also going to miss your keen business mind, and we're going to miss the just incredible intelligence and maturity that you brought to the deliberations in this board. Taking the lead role with the ways that we account for our own behavior, some of the accountability things that you've brought to us, and the ways that we ask for input from the community, some of the town survey stuff and business survey you brought to us. It's really been a pleasure serving with you. When I was thinking about running and felt I just couldn't stand to sit up here in front of the TV and do that every night, which I still don't particularly like very much, I remember you said to me, "Be yourself. There's nobody else that's better at it." So another pithy phrase from Michael Keane. But I really have appreciated working with you, and thank you so much for the opportunity.
Well, it was delightful working.
And I get the chair's prerogative to thank Justin. It shows you with Justin. He had a long-time commitment to this board and gave of himself. But we also learned that, we have work and families that are commitments that we have to recognize beyond this. And Justin would have been much more involved in his last year if he wasn't committed to his employer to try to make a living. because this is probably not the highest paid job that Justin will ever have. But he did bring a very good common sense approach to town government. And that's all something that we can continue to benefit by. A lot of us live in the clouds, not yours truly, because I can't reach that high, but he gave of himself, and what more can you ask of a quality board member? So I hope the minutes would reflect that is part of what this board recognizes. Now, as far as Michael, you know, what more can you say? It seems like you've been on the board for at least 19 years.
No.
But the only because...
Stop there.
No. You have the board's prerogative, the chair's prerogative, and you're not going to be recognized until I tell you. You've done more in 3 years than most of us will accomplish in whether it's 3, 6, 9, or 12 years. You've given us a sense of direction that we didn't obviously have. A couple of years ago, we talked about a board that wanted to do things different. We weren't going to accept the status quo. And Michael has been a leader in making sure that that hasn't happened. Whether it be the citizen survey, the business survey, the report card, the evaluation of the management, those are areas that would not have happened without leadership, and that leadership came from my wingman right here. More importantly, Michael Keane, as your signs have said, you're keen on Bennington. And it's whether you're sitting here or in another organization or anything else, you have given so much of yourself, and I expect so much of what Edie has allowed you to give, maybe more than she would like. But we hope and expect that you're going to continue to serve your community going forward. We expect you to not give any catcalls out there, but also to be supportive and give us the benefit of your wisdom, which is not going to go away just because you're not sitting here and you're going to be fortunate. I'm looking forward to, with Chad and Carson coming on, I think that'll be exciting. We put both of those kids together, their ages, we don't equal you or me.
Thank you, Tom. Can I say something now? Yeah.
So, but the essence of it...
Will the chair allow me?
No, I'm still...
You're still talking.
My time.
All right.
But I think the town of Bennington owes you a wealth of gratitude, and I certainly do, and I'm going to miss those daily emails and phone calls. But I expect they're going to continue in some form or fashion. Godspeed and keep the wind at your back.
Thank you. May I say a few things? Thank you all very much. It's been a singular privilege to serve with all of you and to serve the town. He just made a comment about my age, and I want to go back to, I'll use that as a way to talk about briefly something my father used to say, because my father liked getting older because he was a very adventurous guy, which I seem to have followed because I've worked all over the world, and I've worked for some fantastic clients, some of the largest companies that you could imagine internationally. They were responsible for giving me a business sense and a structure. Because when you go into a client and you have to go toe-to-toe with a CEO, you really have to be able to say what is on your mind and say what they need to hear, not what you think they want to hear. But going back to my father in this business of getting old and having fun, my father always said, if I knew how much fun it was I was going to have getting older, I'd have gotten older at a younger age, which I think is a very great thing to say. The other thing I will say is that I really expect you guys to execute. You know, we can all plan, we can all put things together, but execution is the thing that really counts. Execution, and then measuring how well you've executed what you've done. In terms of my involvement with things, one of the things we always used to say, you know, you work with a client. I tried to treat Bennington in a sense as a client. What would I do for a client who needed help? And that was part of my point of view. And one of the things that you find when you've worked with a client, Sun Life Financial, the North America's third largest insurance company, has been a client of mine for years, out of Toronto and out of Wellesley, Mass. When you work for a client and with a client for a while, you come away saying, I got that, I did some good things, but I also know where the bodies are buried. And that's one of those things that happens when you sort of work in the select board. You begin to know where the bodies are buried. I'll keep that secret, so I won't reveal where the corpses are.
He buried the bodies.
Yeah. We have some plans. I have some things that I need to do over the next few months that all of a sudden I'm released to do. As many of you know, because I brag about it, I am an Irish citizen and a U.S. citizen, so what Edie is making me do is dust off both passports, because we'll be on the road a bit, and I certainly will be on the road a bit doing a few things. I found this to be a lot of fun, but I think you make the fun that you want to have in life, and that's been one of my goals, and I think it's something that I'm becoming an artist at. So that's all I have to say, except, guys, execute. Do well. Chad, Carson, get up here and do your best, really. And don't take no for an answer. My father always used to say, don't take crap from anybody either. That's a good thing to say. That's it. That's all. We're done. Thank you. And Stu, one thing.
Seriously?
Yes, seriously. In the job description for the community development director,
he's applying.
Point 9, be the secretary of the Historic Preservation Commission and act in a staff capacity to the commission. I think with regard to the whole job description, that's a bit like putting a fish on a bicycle. So I would recommend changing that.
Well, unfortunately, the ordinance that allowed us to create the HPC requires that the community development director be the secretary to the commission.
Yeah, nice, that is correct. Okay.
We have any other business to come before us? If not, a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you very much, folks. Thank you, folks. Thank you.